In this screencast, we're going to work an example problem using a non-dilute absorber. The overall concept of this problem is we're taking a gas stream that contains CO2 in a nitrogen carrier gas, and we're trying to transfer a large amount of that CO2 into a liquid stream or a solvent stream, and in this case we're using water. We've been given a flow rate of the entering gas stream, the composition of the entering gas stream, and also a process specification in terms of how much of the CO2 we need to remove from that gas stream. And we're also given a process specification on the relative flow rates of the liquid and the gas streams. Now, our overall approach to solving this problem is broken down as follows. First, we're going to look at this system and determine whether it's dilute or concentrated. The next step would be to define the known flows and compositions for the system. Then we're going to approach this knowing that this is an equilibrium-driven process and get the equilibrium data appropriate for this problem. And then finally, we're going to find the operating line and step off the stages as appropriate. Now, the question of whether this is a dilute or concentrated system really comes down to the idea of, are we having a major change in the mass flow rates of the system? When we do calculations in a dilute system, we're assuming that the flow rates aren't changing. To determine whether or not that's a valid assumption, all we have to do is determine if there's a large change in the flow rates of either of the streams. Since we're pulling CO2 out of a gas stream, the simplest thing for us to do is to determine how much CO2 is being pulled out and see how much that changes the mass flow rate of that gas stream, or the molar flow rate of that gas stream. So we know we have 100 moles per hour of gas coming in the system total. From that 100 moles per hour, we're removing 65% of the total amount of CO2. So we can calculate the amount of CO2 removed from this stream just by multiplying the 100 moles per hour total that comes in times the fraction of that is CO2, which is the 0.08 specification we had in the problem statement. These two numbers together determine the total amount of CO2 coming in, and we're removing 65% of that. So by multiplying these numbers together, we've determined that we are removing 5.2 moles per hour of CO2. When we compare that to 100 moles per hour that's total coming in, we see we have over a 5% change in gas flow rate. So we would consider that a relatively large change in gas flow rate. So as we move forward in this problem, we're not going to assume that it's a dilute system. So now let's look at our process schematic and start defining terms that are appropriate for this system. Since we're not working with a dilute system, we're dealing with concentrated absorbers, we're going to look at gas flow rates, but these gas flow rates are going to be flow rates of the carrier gas, not the total gas flow rate. And the flow rate of the liquid stream we're dealing with is going to be just moles per hour of solvent. Since we're only dealing with moles per hour of either carrier gas or solvent, we know that these flow rates aren't going to change throughout our system. But in order to deal with flow rates in terms of carrier gas and solvents, we need to redefine our mole fractions in terms of mole ratios. So in the gas stream, we're going to have a mole ratio of moles of CO2 per mole of carrier gas. And in the solvent stream, we're going to be dealing with a mole ratio of moles of CO2 per mole of solvent. So now let's start to define some of these parameters. For the flow rate of the carrier gas, we know the flow rate of gas going in is 100 moles per hour, and we know the composition of that stream is 8 mole percent CO2 and 92 mole percent nitrogen. So if we take the 92 mole percent nitrogen, multiply that by the flow rate, we can determine that we have 92 moles per hour of nitrogen coming in. So that's going to be the flow rate of the nitrogen both in the entering and exiting gas stream. Now when we calculate the mole ratios are easily determined by taking the mole fraction and dividing by 1 minus the mole fraction. Since we're given information about the mole fraction of the inlet gas stream, we can quickly now determine the mole ratio of the inlet gas stream. So if we take this, look at the mole fraction coming in of 8 mole percent CO2 per total moles of gas coming in, and divide that by 1 minus this mole fraction, that mole fraction now is in terms of moles of nitrogen divided by total moles of gas stream. And now we're going to notice when we do the division that the units are just going to come down to moles of CO2 per mole of nitrogen, and that's what we refer to as a mole ratio. Now that we have the mole ratio for the gas stream coming in, we'd like to figure out the mole ratio of the gas stream exiting. Well, we know the mole ratio of the gas stream exiting is just the moles of CO2 that are in the outlet stream divided by the moles of carrier gas in the outlet stream. Now, we already know the molar flow rate of carrier gas exiting, so we already know the denominator of this in terms of moles per hour. The next thing for us to figure out is how many moles of CO2 are going in that outlet stream per hour. So we can determine that by subtracting the moles of CO2 that are coming in per hour, so the molar flow rate of CO2 in, and subtracting from that the molar flow rate of CO2 that we removed. We already calculated this term, moles of CO2 removed per hour, when we were determining whether this is a concentrated or a dilute system. So let's take the molar flow rate of CO2 in. We know that's 8 moles per hour. We're subtracting from that the 5.2 moles per hour that's removed through the absorption process, and we're left with 2.8 moles of CO2 removed per hour. Now, when we plug that into this top equation, we end up with 2.8 moles per hour of CO2 in that exiting gas stream, and we also have a molar flow rate of 92 moles per hour of nitrogen in that gas stream. So we have a molar ratio of 0.0304 in that exiting gas stream. We also know that the solvent coming in is pure solvent, so we know the mole ratio for that solvent stream is zero. The other parameters, the solvent flow rate, we're going to figure out based on a minimum solvent flow rate and using the process specification. And then the final composition is going to be dependent on that flow rate, so we're going to have to figure these out later. Now, since absorbers are fundamentally equilibrium processes, we need to get equilibrium data to design these. So for an absorber, we're going to be using equilibrium data derived from Henry's law. Henry's law is very simply taking the mole fraction in the gas phase, and that's going to be equal to the Henry's law constant derived for the particular conditions you're working in, divided by the total pressure, and we're going to multiply that by the mole fraction in the liquid stream. Now, for our particular situation, I looked up the Henry's law constant for this system in terms of atmospheres per mole fraction, and the total system pressure given in the problem statement is 1 atmosphere. So now we know a way of relating mole fraction in the gas phase and the mole fraction in the liquid phase, and relating those just by this number 1640. So now that we have this equilibrium data, let's go ahead and plot that and start working towards our equilibrium design. So I've set up an Excel spreadsheet where we have mole fractions both of the liquid phase and the gas phase, and I've gone ahead and filled in the mole fractions ranging from 0 all the way up to the maximum mole fraction we have in the system, which is 0.08 CO2. Now, for the mole fractions of the liquid phase that corresponds to these gas phase fractions, we need to fill that in using the equilibrium data from Henry's law. We know that they're related by 1640, so we're going to rearrange this equation above, where we just take this gas phase fraction, divide by 1640, and that gives us our liquid phase fraction. We fill in those values just by taking the gas phase number, dividing by 1640, and now we have a relationship between X and Y. Now, since we're not dealing with a dilute system, we're working with mole ratios, so we need to convert these into mole ratios so they agree with our operating line that we're developing. So the mole ratio, again, is just simply the mole fraction divided by 1 minus the mole fraction, and that's true for both the liquid phase mole fractions and the gas phase mole fractions. So we can fill those in very quickly using Excel, do those calculations, and now we've plotted over here the relationship between the gas phase mole fraction, which are moles of CO2 divided by moles of nitrogen, and the liquid phase mole fraction, which is moles of CO2 divided by moles of water. So now that we have our equilibrium data, we're going to move forward and determine the operating line for this system that we're going to use for the design. The operating line is nothing more than a material balance on CO2 in this system. So we have a relationship that's been derived that is our gas phase mole ratio is equal to some slope, which is defined on our solvent flow rate divided by our carrier gas flow rate, multiplied by the mole ratio in the liquid, and then we have some information on an intercept. But this is just a line defining the relationship between the mole ratios in the gas and the liquid phase. Now, since we know this is nothing more than material balance, we know the point x equals 0 and y equals 0.0304 absolutely has to be on that line, since this is a set of conditions that exists in our system. So when we come back to our Excel spreadsheet, I've entered the point 0, 0304 and plotted that on the graph as the first point in our operating line. Now the other piece of information we can use to define our operating line for the system is knowing the process parameter that we're operating at 1.5 times the minimum S over G ratio of flow rates. So our first step is to determine what that minimum ratio of flow rates S over G is. If we go back to the equation for the operating line, we see the S over G is nothing more than the slope of the operating line. So we need to find a minimum slope that will get us from these conditions to our inlet composition of 0.087. So that minimum slope is going to correspond to an infinite number of stages, which will be a pinch point at 0.087. So I've drawn this point here on the equilibrium line, and we also have our exiting composition here. So this operating line represents the minimum ratio of S over G that will accomplish this separation. We can calculate the slope of that line just by dividing the change in Y over the change in X, and that's going to represent our S over G minimum. We know that the actual S over G is going to be 1.5 times that S over G minimum, so with that, we've actually determined that the ratio of our flow rates is actually going to be this term here, 1.74 times 10 to the third. So now we want to define a new operating line using this actual S over G ratio of flow rates. So I'm going to define a new line. I'm going to use X values that are just the same as the X values for our mole ratios, but the selection of these XR values is relatively arbitrary. Now I'm going to define the Y values using the equation for the operating line. So for that cell, I'm just going to take our previous Y value and add to that our slope times the change in X value. And then we just fill in the rest of the cells using those same basic formulas. Now all that's left to do is just to step off the stages and see how many equilibrium stages we need. Since we're doing a graphical method, I blew up this plot just so it's easier to see the stages and work with them. Now my approach is going to start at one end of the column where we have a composition of X is equal to 0, Y is equal to 0.03, and I'm going to step off stages until I reach the other end of the column. And the other end of the column we know is going to have a composition of gas exiting in terms of a mole ratio of 0.087. And from the operating line, we can determine the composition of the exiting solvent stream. All right, so now we're going to step off the stages. So we're going to start off at this end of the column, and this is the composition of the entering and exiting streams. And now we need to go to that first equilibrium stage. So if we're at an equilibrium stage, we're going to be in contact with that equilibrium data. So we're going to draw a line across the equilibrium data, and this is going to be the composition of our first equilibrium stage. Now we want to see what the composition is in between stages. In between stages, the compositions are dictated by our operating line. So we're going to draw a line up to the operating line. Now we're going to move to our next equilibrium stage. Our next equilibrium stage, again, is going to be in contact with the equilibrium data. And then we see when we do two full equilibrium stages, we've actually overshot our target compositions. So now to determine the number of fractional stages needed, we're just going to see the fractional distance along this line. This line indicates how much of that second stage we needed. So if we draw a line from our target final composition down to this line, we can see that we have approximately 1.9 equilibrium stages required for this system.